who's been really involved in making networks both within the States, towards Japan, towards Canada, has strong affiliations, University of Toronto and mutual projects, and even Singapore. So person that is also a kind of global mover and network builder and has been so important to gaining some understanding under these topics. I'm so pleased to welcome her today. Thanks.
So thanks for accommodating me here in your class, and also for the non-students, thank you for coming to hear me. And I know it's like in the middle of the afternoon, it's really raining. And so I'm sure people are kind of sleepy, so I'm happy. I was happy to see the cookies there. So a lot of you will have the sugar high and will stay awake as I talk here in the next 45 minutes or so. So the talk I'm going to give is based on this collaborative project that I'm doing right now with a geographer from the University of Toronto, Rachel Silvey. So she and I are doing a study on the labor and migration conditions of Filipino and Indonesian domestic workers in the United Arab Emirates. And so in this talk, we're going to go a little bit into their lives. But before that, I want to give us a global overview of the state of domestic worker migration and to sort of make the case of how Rachel and I are looking at one of the worst destinations for migrant domestic workers globally. So domestic work, according to the International Labor Organization, refers basically to work performed in a household or for a household. So domestic workers would include house cleaners, elderly caregivers, and families. So something momentous actually happened in 2011, and in 2011, the ILO successfully passed Convention 189, or what's otherwise known as the Convention on Decent Work for Domestic Workers. And so this passage basically suggests this global recognition for domestic work. And so what this convention tried to do was establish a standard of employment universally. And so indeed, this convention was successful, we could say, as it led to the enactment of legal reforms for the greater protection of domestic workers in various countries. So for example, after the convention passed, both Singapore and Lebanon revisited their labor laws for domestic workers and actually instituted a mandatory weekly day off. So further suggesting the recognition of domestic work is the existence of official recruitment programs. And one country, obviously, is Canada, that has such a recruitment program. And so in these countries, domestic workers can actually legally enter and become a resident with a domestic worker visa. And so besides Canada, other countries with such a program would be Italy, Denmark, Israel, Lebanon, and various Gulf Cooperative Council countries. And that would be Kuwait, Oman, United Arab Emirates, and Saudi Arabia, and it would also include various destinations in Asia, such as Malaysia, Taiwan, and Singapore. And so despite these positive changes, there's actually still a limit to the full recognition of domestic work. And so across the globe, migrant domestic workers are not given complete rights as workers. Instead, they're what we could call tied workers or bound workers, as their regularization is basically contingent on their live-in employment and sole and continuous employment with their sponsor and their limited access to the labor market. So in this talk, what I want to do is examine this legal status of migrant domestic workers. More specifically, I want us to look at their legal constitution as what we could say are unfree workers, and address the question of how this unfreedom shapes their labor conditions. So as I will establish, most countries with a proactive recruitment program, including Canada, have instituted policies and regulations that basically render migrant domestic workers bound laborers with limited ability to fully participate in the labor market. And so legally, domestic workers are not recognized as independent workers, but they're constituted as household dependent. So their legal status basically, their terms of membership basically constitutes them as household dependents of their sponsor. So of the estimated 86 million migrant workers worldwide, most are actually unskilled. Women make up about 49% of the international migrant labor force, and the vast majority of this 49% are unskilled workers, and they're mostly employed as domestic workers. So migrant domestic workers originate from a wide range of source countries that would include, but are not limited to, Ethiopia and Kenya, Estonia, Poland, and Ukraine, and Eastern Europe. From Asia, they come from Nepal, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, the Philippines, and Indonesia. And in Latin America, source countries include Brazil, El Salvador, Mexico, Nicaragua, and Peru. And across the globe, the largest number of migrant domestic workers are actually of Indonesian origin. There's an estimated 2.4 million of them, followed by Filipinos, where there's an estimated 1.4 million domestic workers working outside of the country. And these workers are primarily concentrated in Asia and the Middle East. So while migrant domestic workers include irregular workers, that's like undocumented workers, the vast majority are actually regularized workers, and they're holders of what we could say is a quote-unquote servant visa. And so countries that recognize the need of their citizens, of their citizenry for paid domestic labor, and accordingly grant the allocation of a working visa for such workers span the globe, as we can see from this chart here. So these destinations include, but are not limited to, Gulf Cooperative Council countries, such as Saudi Arabia and the UAE, Scandinavian countries like Denmark and Norway, the country of Israel, and various destinations in Asia, including Singapore, Taiwan, Malaysia, and Hong Kong. So in all these destinations, migrant domestic workers share the status of being bound labor. So again, bound laborers is like they have to live in with their employer. So Italy is the only country where they do not have to live with their employer. In all these other countries, like if you have a servant visa, you have to live with your employer. And in varying degrees, you actually cannot change your employer very easily. So by calling attention to this shared status of domestic workers as unfree workers, I don't mean to disregard the differences in the work conditions across countries. And so, like, when I talk about this, like, Europeans get very mad at me whenever I say, you know, like, the legal status of domestic workers is the same as Denmark and the UAE, they get very mad. So I'm not saying that the work conditions are the same, I'm just saying the legal status are quite similar. So without question, labor conditions for migrant domestic workers are vastly different across the globe. And so, for instance, there's a variety of work standards in terms of hours, for example. So in Denmark, they supposedly do not work for more than 3 to 5 hours a day, while their counterparts in the United Arab Emirates are actually legally entitled to 8 hours of rest per day. So that means it's technically legal for them to work 16 hours a day. So another example, predominant types of employment vary across countries. So like in Denmark, they're mostly childcare workers. In Canada, you have to like need childcare for you to qualify to have a domestic worker come in here. In contrast, in Taiwan and Israel, you have to need someone who does like long-term care or care for the disabled for you to be able to qualify to get a domestic worker. And in countries like the UAE, Singapore, and Hong Kong, you just have to basically need like someone to clean your house and cook, and you could qualify for a domestic worker even without children. And then finally, if you look at their wages, you see this like vast differences. So in Canada, you can get paid more than $1,000 here. In contrast, monthly salary in a country like the UAE is about $215. In Singapore, it's about $365. So you can see this like just vast differences in salary. But despite these differences, so regularized migrant domestic workers, like I said, share this legal status of being a bound laborer. So in every destination, their legal residency is contingent on the sponsorship of an employer. So what does this mean? So it means that domestic workers can only legally reside and work in the host society if they are continuously and solely employed by a resident sponsor as a live-in worker. And so what fortifies this bound status for them as unfree workers is their limited ability to change jobs or to change sponsors. So in varying degrees, receiving states make it difficult for migrant domestic workers to change jobs. So for example, in Singapore, domestic workers cannot change their job without the permission of their current employer. So even if you complete your 2-year contract with your employer, you cannot switch jobs and like secure employment with another new sponsor unless this old sponsor whose contract ended, quote unquote, releases you. And so this is actually also the case in Gulf Cooperative Council countries such as Kuwait, Oman, Saudi Arabia, and the United Arab Emirates. So in Hong Kong, domestic workers do not need to secure the permission of their employer to change jobs, but if they ever want to, they're only given a 2-week window by the Hong Kong government to find a new employer. And so this actually deters domestic workers from changing jobs, even if they dislike their occupation. So in Denmark, au pairs can only change employers twice in the course of 2 years. In Israel, they can only change their job 3 times during the first 63 months. Then if your residency surpasses 63 months, you can never change jobs, and you have to stay with that employing household to not get deported. And you would have to leave, however, once the person you're caring for dies. And then in Taiwan, domestic workers can only change employers can never change jobs. And in Taiwan, you can only change jobs if your employer was deemed by the government unfit to employ you. So how would that happen? If they died, if they declared bankruptcy, if they left the country, you know, if they, you know, went to prison, and so, but if they are able to employ you, you cannot change employers. And then as a final example, of course, is Canada. So here, domestic workers, I think as you all know, they have to work continuously for one household for 2 years, in a course of 4 years to be able to qualify for land and status. And so then that puts them in a very tight like timeline. So all these examples do not only indicate the limited freedom of domestic workers to change employers, but it also tells us about the designated power of the employer as a despot. And so employers have the power to not only fire their domestic workers, but they actually have the power to also deport them at will. So notably, this power aggravates the vulnerability of domestic workers and encourages them to tolerate less than ideal work conditions. So the legal incorporation of migrant domestic workers as bound laborers basically renders them a household dependent in most destinations across the globe. And their legal status as dependents basically agrees with the view of domestic workers as quote unquote one of the family, described by feminist sociologists including Mary Romero and Judith Rollins as a controlling mechanism used by employers to basically solicit uncompensated labor. So not surprisingly then, most countries do not offer labor protection to domestic workers, and if they do, enforcement is very difficult. And Diva Stasiulis and Abigail Bakken, writing on Canada, have made that observation. So not surprisingly then, like I said, the labor protection is like very few and far between. So to just give you a few examples. So in Singapore, domestic workers are exempt from the Employment Act. In Taiwan, domestic workers are not covered by the labor standards law. And so so because of that, the government then instituted the quote-unquote Domestic Workers Protection Act. And so what this Domestic Worker Protection Act does is that it doesn't say these are the standards of employment. It basically just says when you end up in the household, you have the right to negotiate for your terms of employment with your employer. But it doesn't really say like what are fair. It doesn't really guide you to say what are fair conditions. And then in Israel, domestic workers historically had the right to a weekly day off, but a 2009 Supreme Court ruling excluded them from the work and rest hour law. And so they don't have the right to overtime pay, actually, or a day off after that. And then a few countries commendably grant labor protection to domestic workers, and Jordan and Canada are just two examples of countries that do that. I wanted to say Jordan because a lot of times, like Middle Eastern countries, they're stereotyped as just like awful places for domestic workers, but there's actually very strong labor laws in Jordan, I want to say. But the absence of labor protection basically results in the inconsistency of labor conditions for domestic workers. We see this in the inconsistency of the day off, for example. And so, like, you know, most host societies mandate a weekly day off for domestic workers, but some do not. So like I said, like Singapore only instituted their weekly day off in 2013. Before that, domestic workers did not have the right to a day off. But what's interesting in Singapore, not all employers provide a day off, grant a day off to their domestic workers. Many still limit the domestic workers to one or two, like once or twice a month of a day off. And then member states of Gulf Cooperative Council countries, they oftentimes do not give a day off, but what they do is they give you a rest day. So in the UAE, you are not legally obligated to give them a day off, but you're legally obligated to give them a rest day. So what that means is, like, on Sunday, on Friday, the domestic worker does not work, but they can't leave the house, right? So but they're just resting in the house. So those are, like, examples of the terms of employment and what happens because of the lack of labor standards, the absence of labor market protection. But suggesting the ILO's, you know, degree of influence here, like I said, policies in countries across the globe have shown a shift towards this greater recognition of the labor rights of domestic workers. And Singapore, I think, is a great example of that. So how do we make sense, then, of this situation here, of the legal construction of domestic workers as household dependents, and the struggle of receiving countries to render them independent workers? So what explains this partial recognition of domestic work? So why is it that countries are recognizing domestic work as labor by granting, quote unquote, a servant visa, but then they're not fully recognizing it because then they're not granting, like, full labor status to these domestic workers? Instead, they make them bound to their employers as household dependents. So then what we could argue is that, you know, race, fitting the themes of this class, race and gender accounts for, you know, the politics of the non-recognition of domestic workers here. And so then we could say, like, race definitely plays a role. Migrant domestic workers are often deemed undesirable citizens. And so because of this, with the exception of Italy and Canada historically, migrant domestic workers in all other countries do not qualify for permanent residency. And so in some countries, it's like pretty extreme. So in Singapore, for example, you are not qualified to even marry and reproduce with a Singaporean. So if you are a Filipino domestic worker and you fall in love with a Singaporean, you guys can never get legally married in the eyes of the Singaporean state. The Singaporean state will not give you the right to live there permanently as the spouse of this person, even if you give birth to a Singaporean child for this person. And so, you know, there's cases in which, like, a domestic worker falls in love with a Singaporean, goes back home to their country of origin, steals the identity of, or borrows the identity of their sister and marries a Singaporean to go back. So a couple like that got busted and then the person got deported. And so that's just an example. So in a lot of these countries, there's also a residency cap. And so then in Denmark, Taiwan, those are just two examples of countries that place a residency cap for domestic workers. In most other countries, you know, domestic workers can stay until they're 60 years old, but they definitely cannot retire there. So actually, just it's circulating in like Facebook. There was an Indonesian domestic worker who's 59 years old, has worked in Saudi Arabia for 33 years for three generations of one household. And then it's just this like wailing session in the airport because you can see this domestic worker going home to Indonesia on a wheelchair. And then you see three generations of this Saudi household like crying you know, it's a bit, that's a, like, you know, why is she going home? Well, she can't work anymore, but even if they wanted to care for her because she cared for them, they can't because she has to go back because she's hitting, you know, the age limit there. And so then another example, I also like to say the U.S. is also another case that people think, oh, it's such a, you know, accepting country. So in the U.S., they have a non-immigrant visa allocated to domestic workers. So if you're an expat, if you're a business person, if you're a diplomat, you can bring in a domestic worker, but that domestic worker is bound to you and they can never become like a permanent, like they can't transition to permanent residency from that particular status that they have. They could get married, but it's like the only way that they could get residency status. And so, you know, what explains the sort of exclusion of domestic workers, we can say it's definitely sort of biopolitics of the nation going here on here where they are from. Considered like undesirable racial groups from undesirable nationalities, and so they're just excluded from membership in these countries. But then it's not also just race, but it's also gender that shapes the exclusion of these domestic workers. So what we should recognize is that the refusal of nation states to recognize domestic workers as independent labor migrants alludes to the societal dilemma over how to see domestic work, and it's like there's this dilemma over really recognizing it as a real job. That's outsourced to the public, and that I think that there is still this view that it's paid labor that really should be private and unpaid that stays like the female responsibility of the household. So the struggle to recognize migrant domestic workers as independent workers also points to this tension in the defamiliarization of care. So this commodification of the care is haunted by this gendered preference for care to remain a private household responsibility that's primarily done by women with minimal market or state intervention. And so then, you know, there are basically three general schemes of indenture for migrant domestic workers. So I want to recognize it's not all the same, right? So in one scheme, countries minimize the vulnerability of domestic workers by offering them labor protection and pathways to permanent residency. So Canada, you are alone here. And then in another scheme, basically domestic workers are not granted a pathway to citizenship, but they benefit from labor protection. And then a third and final scheme, and so I want to say these are like the worst destinations. And so these destinations basically are those where there are no labor protection and there's no pathway to citizenship. And so the schema actually is also a response that I don't want people to just, or other scholars, the way they rank the hierarchy of, create hierarchies of domestic worker destinations, so they do it by salary. So oftentimes Israel would be like on top there, near Canada, because they get paid a lot. But what I do want to point out is that the legal conditions of their membership is not the most humane. So then, I'm gonna skip this research question part. So then, so what we're doing, my study with Rachel Silvey, is we are looking at the state of domestic work in two worst destinations. And we excluded Israel because they get paid better there. So we're comparing Singapore and the United Arab Emirates. And so we picked those two because besides having the two worst legal conditions, they also have the worst like salary conditions, right? $215 for the UAE, $365 monthly salary for Singapore. And so so for our study, and this is what I'm gonna draw from, we did a lot of research. So we did a lot of interviews with domestic workers, with employers, with migrant recruiters, and with government officials. People think that we did what's called convenient sampling. So convenient sampling is like you basically don't select who you're going to interview. You don't sort of try to diversify your sample. You don't try to even make it close to representative because they're so hard to reach. You're just going to talk to the person who's like you can access regardless of a variety of perspective you get. So that's what's called convenient sampling. So many people assume because domestic workers in, you know, especially in the UAE are very hard to reach, they assume that we just did convenient sampling. So I want to say we did, I like to call it inconvenient sampling. And so we interviewed a diverse group of domestic workers with a day off, without a day off, We try to, we have undocumented and documented domestic workers. We have domestic workers who have worked there for many years, and we also have newcomers in our pool. And we primarily try to diversify by making sure that the type of households where they work is diverse, and so then the domestic workers we interviewed work for Emirati, other Arab, Indian, Filipino, Western households. And so then we also actually interviewed employers in both destinations. And then we did a survey of return migrants and outgoing migrants. We did content analysis of, so what we did was for 2 years, we looked at all newspaper reports of the three largest circulating newspapers in these two countries. And any time the word maid or domestic worker came up, we tagged it, and then we basically analyzed the data to see how domestic workers are being talked about. And then we also did participant observation of the out-migration process and also the recruitment process. So we did participant observation at the agency. So this is where I'm going to draw from in my discussion now. So basically, this larger study that we're doing on domestic workers in Dubai focuses on their legal status, right, as unfree workers. And we're basically asking, how does the status of being unfree, like you're bound to your employer, you cannot quit your job without permission from your employer, right? So how do we understand how that shapes their particular experience? And so there's actually a vast literature on migrant domestic work, yet few have foregrounded this unfree status of domestic workers and examine the effects of this status on their labor conditions. And so I think this is because most studies have focused on the everyday life of these domestic workers, and they're excellent studies, and they've accordingly looked at employer-employee dynamics, the daily work routine of domestic workers, and the ways domestic workers spend their day off. And so only a few scholars have addressed the question of how the legal conditions of membership for domestic workers would potentially shape their labor. So some have looked at this question of if they're undocumented, how does that shape their labor? But not many have looked at, if they're unfree, how does this shape their labor? And so the question remains then, how does the status of domestic workers as bound laborers, that is indentured workers, shape their work conditions? Or we can ask, how does the relationship of an equal dependency between employers and employees shape domestic work? And so one of the first persons to actually address this question had been the British sociologist Bridget Anderson, who examined the effects of indenture on employer-employee relations in Great Britain. And she basically said that this status that I'm talking about basically promotes what she says is a master-slave relationship. Basically, it makes these women so beholden to their employer that they'll just do anything they say, and be very subservient to them, is what she observed. And so the literature that follows does not disagree with Anderson, and so all agree that indenture is nothing but a tool of oppression that employers use to maximize the labor that they can extract from their domestic workers. And so the sociologist Kevin Bales, for example, labels migrant domestic workers as quote-unquote modern-day slaves. They're what he defines as quote-unquote contract slaves. So according to Bales, there's 27 million slaves today, and basically he says there's three kinds of slaves. There's debt slaves, so that's primarily in South Asia, people who inherit their parents' debt. That's what he calls debt slaves, they can never pay it. Then the second is a more classic slavery. When we think about it, it's shadow slavery, which is you're technically owned by this person, and the kids are owned by this person. And he says this is happening still in certain countries in Africa. And then he says that the majority of slaves in the world today is what he calls contract slaves, and that's pretty much the people we're looking at. And so when you hear slavery, you hear this term modern-day slavery, and you think it's that classic slave trade, it's actually not that. It's really talking more about migrant workers who are migrant contract workers. And so in Bale's definition, many migrants in Canada would be slaves. A lot of the farm workers in this country would be slaves. But I think it's a lot more complicated than that. So for me, I pause and reducing this diverse experience to slavery. So Bales can cast this wide net of who is a slave, because he has a very broad definition of slavery. So according to Bales, slavery is a person controlling another person for the purpose of economic advancement. So it's very broad. To him, that's what slavery is. So if you control someone and you're extracting a profit that is unfair, then that's slavery. So he says that the people I'm looking at then is slavery. So I just want to say that his definition of slavery is not like the 1926 League of Nations definition of slavery. And that's like when you own someone, that's like a slave. Like it's a property ownership. And so then besides Bales, also agreeing, you know, with his and, you know, sort of notion of what happens when you are a bound laborer, particularly to the Middle East, is Human Rights Watch, which basically says this is nothing but human trafficking. And so Human Rights Watch released this report in 2014 called I Already Bought You, Abuse and Exploitation of Female Migrant Domestic Workers in the United Arab Emirates. So basically this report is nothing but like this laundry list of all the bad things that will happen to you if you end up a domestic worker in that country. And so then echoing these negative accounts are the analysis of the kafala system, that's a sponsorship system I just described to you guys, in the Middle East by the anthropologist Pardis Madhavi and the sociologist Amrita Pandey. And both analytically reduce the unfreedom of bound labor to a form of what they say is structural violence, which is a term coined by Johann Goultag in 1969 and popularized more recently by Paul Farmer to call attention to how social structures or institutions may harm or cause injury to individuals and then prevent them from meeting their basic needs. So in her book, Gridlock, Madhavi argues that the kafala system, as a system of structural violence, harms by subjecting migrant domestic workers to labor trafficking. And then Pandey, writing on domestic workers in Lebanon, likewise sees the kafala as a form of structural violence that results in the abuse of domestic workers, who in turn are encouraged to become illegal in order to gain control of their labor. And so without question, the kafala and its resulting effect of indenture limits the ability of domestic workers to maximize their labor, right? So it's not like I can say, oh, my neighbor's gonna pay me double, so I'm gonna leave you. You know, I can't really do that under the system. But even though that's the case, I find that structural violence or human trafficking or slavery as a concept to be incomplete in its analysis. And so first, what it does is it reduces our understanding of domestic work to the structures that shape it. So basically, it follows a structural functionalist logic. So this is the structure, and you're just gonna all like follow whatever the structure lets you do. So because they can do that, all employers will just beat up their domestic workers. So that's sort of the logic in their argument. And then second, it also suggests that structures have a uniform effect, but we, I think in this class, should know that agency always comes in and that structures never have a uniform effect because it's complicated by agency. So it's just a kind of a very basic reason why I find these arguments, though compelling, problematic. And then finally, it assumes then that all employers are tyrannical despots who would just basically use their position of power to maximize their ability to extract labor from their domestic workers. And I think there's a lot of good people, even in the Middle East. There's a lot of, you know, so how do we account for them? How do we account for the fact that some employers, you know, they are very devout Islamic people who, you know, recognize humanity, etc. So empirically grounding our discussion then, so this one, I'm going to get into my data now, on unfree labor. So let me take you to one of the worst places in the world where domestic workers can work. And that's the UAE. So there's many ways that we could measure their labor conditions. So I just named some of them here. How am I going to talk about the diversity here? Oh, how much time do I have? Okay. So I'm going to talk to you about their conditions of labor, okay? So why I don't like structural violence? So what we basically found, that there's basically three primary cultures of household employment in the United Arab Emirates. So there are households that dehumanize their domestic workers, there are households that infantilize their domestic workers, and there are households that recognize their domestic workers. So there's all these ways we could, so we could like plug it in, like how is a day off like that? How is a food consumption like that? So in every category, there's like those three types exist. So I'll give you an example. My favorite is food consumption because the domestic workers care about that so much. So in our study, what we found was that some households dehumanize their domestic workers. So in those households, you know, what we found is sometimes employers only feed their domestic workers once a day. And so I'll give you an example. Like, you know, one of the our interviewees, you know, told her employer, if you, like, don't feed me more than once a day, I'll probably die. And then the employer said, well, dogs only eat once a day, so why do you have to eat more than once a day? And then when she asked the husband of this employer the same question, then he says, well, I don't really care if you die, because if you die, I'll just put you in the garbage. You're a Filipino, and you're not Emirati, so I could care less about you. So, you know, that happens. So then you're like, oh, structural violence, oh, slavery, right? But then what I do want to point out that those kinds of situations are few and far between. That's usually like older Emirati from like the boonies, like Ras Al Khaimah, Fujairah, places you guys have probably never heard of and will never go to if you go to the UAE. So these are just like places, you know, in the middle of nowhere. And so the very non-cosmopolitan Emiratis are the ones, and old are the ones that where, and they were like of sound mind when slavery was legal in the UAE. And so then, but there's variations of dehumanized food intake. So sometimes employers will say, this cake is only for us, you cannot eat this cake. Like, that's a form of dehumanization. Not as extreme as you can't eat more than once a day, right? Or sometimes they'll, you know, say, you eat one egg and we eat three eggs. So those kinds of situations happen more commonly than the one meal a day. So that's in this that situation in which, you know, employers are, you know, distinguish the domestic as an other in their household. And it's not just Emirati who do that. Another favorite example of mine, there's one domestic worker we interviewed, the employer told her she couldn't eat the blueberry. She was so upset. And then she's like, after that, she's like, I am never gonna eat any of their food. I get paid enough. I will just go downstairs to the supermarket. She lives in this condo, and I will just buy my food every day, after she was told not to eat the blueberry. And the person who told her not to eat the blueberry is a Swedish wife of a venture capitalist. So I just want to say, it's not just like Emiratis who do this, okay? We can get into this conversation, why do they do it? Because they can. So a second example is the infantilized domestic workers. So this is the situation where employers kind of never really think that this person is a person with needs, desires. They like burgers, they like something. And the employers just sort of say, I'm a good person, this domestic can eat anything they want. But the problem is everything in their house is not something domestic worker likes to eat, right? And so this is basically people who basically think that domestic workers can't think for themselves. There's not an adult with needs and desires. So I'll give you two examples of infantilized households. So one is like a domestic worker works for a South Asian vegetarian family. And this South Asian vegetarian family only likes spicy food. So this domestic worker is like cannot eat anything in this house. Oh, you know, and she's like, okay, telling this in the interview, she's like trying to sneak in pork. And then she's like, oh my God, my employer has such a strong nose and she could smell the pork like a mile away, you know, but I was eating it at 4 a.m. What was she doing awake at 4 a.m? I'm trying to eat this pork at 4 a.m. So that scenario. And then another scenario is like, another domestic worker we interviewed, she is employed by a personal fitness trainer. So what was in this woman's house? Quinoa, like, you know, gluten-free bread, I mean, just name it, right? And it's like expensive stuff. And so then this employer thinks she's so great because she's like, eat whatever you want here. Like, you know, white rice is bad for you, don't eat white rice. So Filipinos, you know, deny them white rice, oh my God, they go crazy, right? So then that's another example of infantilization. So in these infantilized households, it's not like, oh, because these employers are evil, right? We have these great cases too of like employers we interviewed justifying to us why it's like for the good of their domestic that they don't have a day off, you know? And the employee doesn't really think they're doing anything wrong because they're like, you know, protecting the womanhood of this person. So it's not like, oh, I'm keeping this person here because I don't want them to ever have a good time. Yeah, so that's why it's like, oh, when we go out, we take them out with me, you know? So then the third kind of household is the household in which domestic workers, are recognized. And so that's basically, it's like a variety of it. So some employers will say, okay, like, we don't know what kind of food you like, so we will give you a food allowance every month and go buy whatever you want and eat whatever you want. And domestic workers love that because they always eat less than whatever amount of money they're given. So they feel that they can add to their income. Another thing is that the domestic worker will be told, okay, I'm gonna go shopping. What do you want? Like, I'll just buy whatever you want. So they, you know, that, so then the domestic also can do that. Or the third is they say, you are in charge of our household, so you go shopping, here's the money, you buy whatever you want, and the domestics will always like sneak in whatever they want, or they will, you know, cook whatever they want. And the ones that really like that are the ones whose employers allow them to eat Filipino food or Indonesian food and like serve this to the household, you know, like so the family eats the food that the domestic worker likes. So you can see that there's such a variety of employment standards, that variety is not accounted for in our current sort of narratives of slavery, et cetera, et cetera. And so me and Rachel Silvey, therefore see unfreedom as a morally mediated experience, and that our study is trying to capture that moral mediation. And so domestic workers know this to be the case. So what happens, right? So domestic workers, before they go there, so Andrew Gardner writes about construction workers who go to the Middle East, and he basically says, oh, they keep on going because they're like clueless. They don't know they're gonna get abused, so they go. We're like, we didn't find that. They know they can get abused. We don't really have much time, but like in our participant observation of the out-migration sessions, basically the out-migration sessions is like, the group is being told they're bound to the Middle East. You're probably gonna get raped when you go there. So what are you gonna do if you get raped? Like what, you know, and so then these women know they're gonna get abused. So why do they leave still, right? So this is actually a typical house of a domestic worker from the Philippines. They're from rural areas. We actually have labeled them as fourth world migrants, because they tend to be uneducated. Many of them dropped out of high school. Many of them live in a hut without running water or electricity. The poverty is captured by, a house like this won't have electricity, but what they can do is like put an electric line illegally to a neighbor, and then for every piece of, I wanna say equipment, they have to pay the neighbor $2 a month. So like, here's a light bulb. I'm lighting a light bulb illegally through this household, so I paid this household $2. You know, so to charge my cell phone continuously for a month is $2. And it's because they don't have the $120 that you need to install electricity in your house. But to actually, if you had that money, it would actually probably cost you $2 then to maintain this electricity every month. So you can see sort of this like survival economy that they're in, right? That they end up paying much more because they don't have sort of just like what you need to get out of that survival system. So what we have to realize is that they are coming from like dormant economies in rural areas of their country of origin. They are like abandoned citizens of the state with like no like kind of social welfare benefits that they're receiving. And so they're pretty much completely immobilized by poverty. And so then they go to these places without any cost for them because the employers pay for everything. And so it leaves them with two options in life. So their first option is the unfreedom of poverty in their country of origin. And the second option is the unfreedom of servitude in their country of destination. And they all roll the dice and say, I'm going for the unfreedom of servitude. And they're going for the unfreedom of servitude because they hope and pray that they find an employer who recognizes their personhood, and that they do not end up with an employer that basically infantilizes or dehumanizes them. And so it's a last like sort of narrative, like very interestingly, in this one participant observation that I did of a training session for outbound migrant domestic workers from the Philippines to the Middle East, a woman sitting in this situation of rape, it always comes up because they're always warned, you're gonna get raped, you're gonna get raped, you're gonna get raped. The woman next to me, she like raises her hand. She's like, oh, actually, I was raped. I was raped by the air conditioner repairman 3 months ago in Lebanon. And you're like sitting next to her, you're like, and you're going back where? To Kuwait. You're like, what? And for me, it's like, how the hell does she like just erase this, you know, and will herself to get over this trauma, right? And then, so then the teacher basically says, look at this person, she got raped. Anyone changing their mind? Anyone having second thoughts? Do people not want to go to the Middle East anymore? And then like complete silence, people are like, no. But then you're like, oh my God, no one's like, I don't want to do this anymore. Everyone's just like, no, I'm still gonna go. And then this one woman at the back of the room suddenly says, well, we know that each one of us has our own destiny. And that we know that not all of us will end up with her destiny. That's why it's important that all of us pray to God that we do not end up with her destiny. So I think that complicates, you know, the picture of why they go there. And hence, one of the ways we're seeing it is we do see this as a form of indentured mobility, that they know they're putting themselves in this status of servitude, but which means they're bound to their employer with limited freedom. But then it's that mobility, the hope of mobility, that sort of pushes them to risk it, right, and go. So let me end there. Salary when they start.
Okay. And with regards to that, then does it make a difference at all, like in the context of the actual country? Like, because different, you know, like the cost of living in the country kind of varies, so.
Yes. Hold on, let me see it here. Yeah, actually it does, but doesn't, because first they're all live-in workers, so they have no housing costs. And that part of their contract usually means the employer has to pay for their food, right? And so then those basic costs are just covered. So in the UAE, actually, and other countries in the Middle East, their clothes are also paid for by the employers. Even the underwear is purchased by the employers. And so that becomes like an issue, actually, especially like that once a month problem with women. Sometimes employers forget, and it becomes a like dilemma for these women to say, how do I tell my employer, you have to buy it for me, you know? And because so all these basic costs are supposedly covered by the employers. And so that's the UAE. In Singapore, clothes and then are covered, but then that toiletry thing becomes like a problem. Like some employers cover it, some employers don't cover it. So usually the cost is not like really an issue. It does, but that's really only an issue in Hong Kong. So many domestic workers in Hong Kong complain that during their day off, it's like very, very expensive. So the day off is a very expensive ordeal for them. So they would rather, you know, like actually work in Singapore even if they get paid less, because they feel that they actually don't, you know, it doesn't cost them as much, you know, sort of the leisure activities that they end up desiring, right? Yes?
I was curious if there was any differences you noticed between child care versus elder care in terms of freedom, just thinking of how aging people,
yes,
I'm guessing, are more likely to pass away, which in a lot of the countries is probably an opportunity to get the new employer.
Mm-hmm.
But if you noticed anything.
So elder care, usually they are the households that are less likely to want to give domestic workers a day off because of the continuous care of their household, right? And then especially that was such an issue in Singapore, because a lot of times, like Sunday, right, is domestic workers want it, all their friends are out. Then the employer's like, me too. Like, I want to go out because I'm going to go to church, you know? And so then elder care becomes more of an issue. Like, I find that the dependency, the level of dependency of the worker is less in other situations. And so because of that, there's more flexibility that is granted those workers. But it doesn't necessarily mean domestic workers get paid more if they do elderly care. A lot of times, like we notice in our participant observation of recruitment agencies in Singapore, it's those who are super, super desperate that just pay, like, because their fees, like they left their employer granted them like So the employer can say, no, you can't find another job, so go deport, get deported. Or they can say, you have 1 week to do it. So they can say, you have 2 weeks to do it. The maximum is you have 1 month to do it. So it's those people who are like, it's the end of the 30 days and it's 29th day, and if they don't find an employer today or tomorrow, they're getting deported from Singapore. So they're the ones who end up taking the job of like the long-term care. Yeah. Yes?
Wasn't Pandey also, didn't she also write about like how maternal care drain in like other countries? I don't remember if it was Pandey, but like they were also talking about like domestic workers that were going from like university graduates in Philippines and
yeah.
all that. Do they have like different destinations from these people who are like choosing or like?
Yes, and so that's something that's not been really discussed in the literature, and that's something we're actually going to talk about, like how there's, you know, a diasporic flow from the Philippines, and that diasporic flow actually ends, like, it's not like they're meeting, but that there's different destinations according to the human capital of domestic workers. And the vast majority of domestic workers, like 60% of them, are actually in the Middle East. And we actually don't know much about them because most work on domestic workers, especially from the Philippines, have been outside the Middle East, and the ones in the Middle East have been very, very few, right? But they actually constitute the majority, so that's sort of what compelled myself and Rachel Silvey to do this study together. And that we found that while those who are going to like Hong Kong, even some in some cases Singapore, are what you can call third world migrants, they're from like urban areas, they were gainfully employed prior to migration in the formal economy. They had finished high school at the very least, had a few years of college. If they finished college, they're probably going to end up in Canada or Italy. But if they've like, you know, if they have at least finished high school, they're going to go to an Asian destination. It's those who are, you know, super rural poor, lived in a hut. These are the people that Alejandro Cortez said do not have the means and resources to migrate, are the ones who are actually the people migrating to the Middle East. And so then this is something that's not been captured in the literature. What we also found is that there's actually been a shift that before migration was very network driven.
Mm-hmm.
So you follow your friends help you, but it's actually now agency driven. And so like you and I are friends, you are Oman, and I say, I want to go abroad too. She's like, hey, go to my aid. You tell me to go to your agency in Manila, thinking I'm going to end up in Oman with you. But then when I get there, they're like, no job orders for Oman, only Kuwait. I'm like, oh, great, I'm in Kuwait. You know, so that's sort of what happens. Or even if we do it together. It's like, hey, we're going to go to this agency, and then you and I end up in Oman. You're in the northern tip of the country, and I'm in the southern tip of the country. You know, so it's like, so this agency-driven migration is what's going on. And this agency-driven migration is what's enabling like the very poor to migrate. That's what's going on. That's sort of very new. Yes, I'm sort of going to go like this. Yeah.
It seems like there's a lot of emphasis on the employer.
Yes.
Do you get the sense that there are any, that this alleviates the responsibility of the government to protect labor standards for these domestic workers? Or,
yes.
Is all the emphasis on the employer and that it kind of alleviates the government from having any formal responsibility?
Yeah, no, so in this talk, I didn't really get a chance to talk about the governments, but I sort of hinted a little bit on it in this talk, because what we're talking about, what we found was that there's this liminal recognition of domestic work, and it's that liminal recognition that enables employers, or places employers in this despotic power vis-a-vis employers, vis-a-vis domestic workers. So what's actually going on is that so governments know that, like sending states know that they are sending their citizens in highly vulnerable situations. So the question of our study basically is like, there's a status of unfree labor. How do various stakeholders recognize and accordingly act on this unfree status? So I didn't really get a chance to talk about what sending governments do. So sending governments actually have very, very robust protectionist programs. And so these protectionist programs basically are what they've implemented to respond to to the likelihood of abuse of their workers. So they're trying to set up programs that will supposedly minimize those abuses. So what do? They have memorandums of understanding that they set up between countries. So these are like basic standards of employment. And they do that because countries like the Saudi Arabia and the UAE, there's no labor standards. Like there's no labor laws. So there's like no labor protection. So then they try to implement that pre-migration. They also then have these training programs. So these training programs are not just like, oh, let me show you how to cook, but it's also like sort of empowerment classes, like what kind of risks are you gonna get, like what are the vulnerabilities you're gonna face. So it's like, what about you're gonna miss your children, you're not gonna have a day off, you're gonna get raped, you're gonna be overworked, and so then they have like these empowerment classes, which is like, what are the words that you will likely see that your employers are probably going to use when they talk about you? Like, be aware of those words, so when they're speaking in Arabic, you know what they're talking about. So like the words that you hear in these classes are like donkey, stupid, imbecile, you know. So it's like, so you can see that they're like empowering domestics for the worst things that will happen to them. But the problem is that like super high regulation of domestic workers ends up like disempowering them, because what happens is, like I just talked about this, one of the things they do is that we are gonna mandate the agency. Like, so you cannot, like me as a migrant worker, I cannot just suddenly leave and say, I wanna go to the UAE and follow my friend. But what's gonna happen is if I'm trying to leave and I didn't go through a migrant recruiter, they're gonna offload me, meaning that they will deny my exit from my country. So in the Philippines, they actually have a program that tries to see like if you are a real tourist or a fake tourist. A fake tourist is like a person who is actually leaving not to be a tourist, but to be a labor migrant. So if they suspect that you're one of those, they actually prevent you from departure. So that's like another like whole story of like craziness, right? And so they have these programs, but what we found is that those programs, they have positives and negatives, and it complicates the situation, and that they make domestic workers like more, like less empowered. So what's happening is that they're highly regulating migration, but they're not regulating the labor. So the labor is not regulated, but the migration is, and it has a negative effect on these workers. That's what happens. Yes?
It might be a stupid question, but what's the main aim of your research and work? Are you planning to affect some laws or...
Yes. Why do we do what we do? I'm looking at the other professors here. It's like,
what's the auditory of your, like, who you aiming for?
So a lot of times we're motivated by other scholars who annoy us. We're like, oh my God, I can't believe they argue this so wrong. Like I already said it, the people who annoyed me, you know, like the structural functionalists. That's a motivation. So you're like, it's more complicated, you know, so let me show you how much more complicated it is. So we're definitely motivated by, academics, right? Like academic pursuits. But then, like, we choose to study something like domestic workers, right? And then it's also because there is this social good that you hope arises out of it, that it helps them somehow improve their labor conditions, right? But it's also like very sort of dreamy and unrealistic to say, oh yeah, I can do this, you know? But the good thing is, because we actually have had unparalleled access, so the access that we've gotten is totally like no one has ever been able to do the amount of research that we've been able to do to get access, to get really like the intricacies of their labor and migration. Many organizations are like approaching us. So we have presented our work to the ILO. We have presented our work to the U.S. Department of Labor, the state, because they don't like me. That's another story. But the U.S. Department of Labor, we've the International Bureau of that office, and we actually gave them very, very helpful stuff, because we were talking about how, like, when people are abused, like, how they use social media, so they're actually implementing some stuff based on what we were telling them. So that's good. But it's, like, funny, but sometimes it's, like, you know, be careful what you, like, wish for, because... We ended up assisting Human Rights Watch, and that was probably the worst thing we could have done, because before we really liked them, and afterwards we found out that they're much more politically motivated. So for them, these sort of nuances that we were seeing, they just completely erased them and came up with this report that was just like, you know, crazy, you know, just sort of saying everything that happens there is bad. And that's like, you know, not good to do because first it's inaccurate, but secondly it also makes it very difficult for researchers to go in there because the government gets mad. Then the government like gets defensive and the government doesn't want us to come in there anymore. So Rachel Silvey and I actually, because we don't want to be like, there's a person, like her last name is Abdi, she teaches at University of Minnesota. She wrote about Ethiopian, the Ethiopian diaspora, and some of the, so it's a three-country study. One of the places she looked at was the UAE. So in her book, she's like, I only interviewed 10 people because it was so hard to find them. And then I had to be like kind of this like, you know, undercover like agent because I didn't want the government to see me. And it was like, oh, you know, like scary, I'll get arrested. And then you have these crazy stories like that. And like we were like, you know what, this is crazy. So what we just did was we told the department, the Ministry of Labor at the UAE that we were there. And we said we would be happy to tell them what we're doing. And then we actually gave them our first article, and they were it's similar to this, like we talked about indentured mobility. And they were not mad. And you know, they were telling us that it's not like, we're not denying that the employers abuse domestic workers, but we also know that not all of them abuse domestic workers. And exactly what we're saying, right? And so that, so they actually, you know, said that they want us to come back and make a presentation for them, but we don't really want to do that because we don't really think they're going to do anything at the end, you know, the UAE. Yeah. And so, yeah, so then I think, I mean, they're trying. I mean, I shouldn't say that because they are trying. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
So I wonder if you could extend your discussion about the two and freedom of poverty and servitude.
Okay.
Because the way you presented it, and it was rushed towards the end, so I'm sure you have to have this information, but I'd imagine someone is being presented with a situation of poverty, of deep poverty, and another situation of potential income generation with the added potential of repatriation of income back to country of origin.
Yeah, yes.
So that presents a very powerful distinction.
Yes, yeah.
And then the second comment, if you get to it, is did you hear stories about the primary relationship of servitude, i.e. between the domestic worker and the woman in the household?
Yes.
Because I come from South Africa, if you can hear my accent.
Yeah.
And this was many years ago, an author there, Jacqueline Koch, wrote a book called
Maids
and Madams.
Yeah, it's a very good book, yes.
And she really focused on that relationship.
Yes.
And I wonder if that emerged at all in the book.
Okay. So, two questions here. Let me start with the second one and then the first question. So, the Maids and Madams dynamic there. So, that was like one of the challenges for us was that there was this notion of like the evil madam, and there was this notion that sort of that the men are like nicer employers, right? And that's a narrative we didn't really want to go to, but a lot of the domestic workers we interviewed would say that their sir is nice and their madam is like evil, right? But then we, looking at that more closely, is definitely among the runaways that we looked at, definitely there were higher cases of people running away because of mistreatment of women in the household. Right? But we feel that that mistreatment does not, you know, it also stems from the fact that because it's the women who are in charge of their labor, and that men are actually very complicit in this, even in their absence, right, is what we wanted to recognize. But we also recognize that for many of the women, they're actually like very like powerless vis-a-vis the men in their households. And most cases of abuse that we found was really more when it wasn't like that households were always abusive, but cases of abuse more frequently happened when someone was having a bad day, and then they like take it out on the domestic worker the same way you take it out on a dog. And so a lot of times, you know, the people who were like beaten up, really like physically assaulted, you know, they would be telling me, but it was so confusing because she was so nice. She was always so nice. She was always, you know what I mean? This was just like something just like snap. But obviously, you know, because they can snap, that's why they snap, right? Because it just really, the unequal power relationship just really manifests in that ability to take it out, the domestic worker, like they're taking it out from the dom. That's like primarily how we saw it. But there was also never, in the US, there's this like trend of like, you know, like, we were at how the new Sotelo calls personalism, like, oh, I'm like friends with my domestic worker. Or even in Italy, I found a little bit of that, where it's like, this is a person, right? There was not really much of that. There was never any, and if there was the few domestic employers who opened up to their domestic workers, it was also an uneven exchange, right? So it's always kind of the domestic getting, kind of being the sponge of all the domestic, of all the employers' issues, but it's never a two-way relationship that's going on there. And so then in terms of the sort of like real bona fide friendships, like long-term friendships between domestics and employers, it doesn't really exist in our case. And then, so then the second question about so the lack of mobility or the presence of mobility, and so for this sort of binary that we set up, just because it's just an easy way to explain like why they take this risk, you know, because they go there knowing the worst possible things could happen to them, and yet they go, and we're trying to understand that desperation that they come from, you know, that, and we find that that's like a viable explanation of that desperation that they come from. What I should note is that desperation also stems from how they often are women without a male breadwinner. So, you know, the women who end up in the UAE, none of them have a breadwinning spouse, like in that club. Or if they do, the guy is a womanizer with many affairs, and the women are just like fed up, right? And so it's the men are not breadwinners because, you know, as men without any labor market opportunities, that sort of, that they married a man like that, and so then they feel that they are the only ones who can sort of lift up their household. Or they are actually single mothers, and that's actually more common for in our study. It's like a large number of them were single mothers who were, you know, trying to raise their kids on their own. And so there is that added extra layer of their inability to get out of that, you know, negotiate that position of poverty that they have. They have that sort of feeling of sort of less bodies to, you know, scramble with in that local economy that is actually very, very dormant. So, you know, so a lot of them are, you know, from incredibly, incredibly rural areas. And that many of our interviewees are from like the Muslim region of Mindanao, and so then there's like a lot of just like violence and like military and like Muslim fighting, so they're actually very kind of tumultuous spaces also, is what's going on there. So it's just places that you really just want to leave, and there's you can't really like move up from there, right? But then, you know, I think we're deciding that we're going to end the book that we have yet written a word for, but we're imagining what the book will be like. The last chapter will be called Unmet Hopes, you know? Because while they are, you know, like, feeling that they are going to do that, get out of the poverty, I mean, it was so sad, because then what we found out was, like, do they ever get out of it? For the majority of them, they don't, you know? And a lot of times, it's like they accumulate savings, but then what happens is because life happens, and then it basically wipes out their savings. So they're from these places with very poor infrastructures. So a typhoon will hit and will blow away their house. There's like mudslides. I mean, it's just like, oh, all my savings for 4 years gone because my house was like wiped away by this typhoon, you know? Or like father gets cancer, mother gets cancer, sister gets cancer, and then suddenly it's like gone. So that happens to a lot of them. You know, it's like they are just sort of like the wages that they get is just enough to survive on a day-to-day basis, that the accumulation of wealth is never there for them. So then at the end, you ask them, well, what do you really want to accomplish? So for them, it's like, I just want to make sure that my children don't have to become domestic workers. And so that's like kind of the limit of their success. So the super successful ones are those whose children end up following them into the UAE, but as like store clerks. So some of the jobs that, restaurant workers, stock room, like fillers and stuff. But some actually have kids who are also domestic workers in the UAE, so then those are the ones who are very sad because they're 58 years old and the 22-year-old kid is about to start domestic work in the, in the region while they're going home. So while we say there's this possible mobility, unfortunately, our findings were very depressing, actually. Not many got out of poverty. Yes?
So it sounds like you're looking at a lot of the dynamics and everything of how this work is regulated, and I understand that. However, just going back to the source of where these workers come from, I am wondering if you're looking to the cultural aspects a little bit more, because it's not always, and I mean this may be a big statement, but I don't think that it's always from desperation, because I've seen some other studies and documentaries talking about the culture around this work. A lot of countries, they welcome this sort of work and they take pride in the fact that I've heard that I was watching this documentary called The Chain of Love, and apparently in the Philippines, these workers are like really, they're wanted in other countries because they come from religious cultures, they're good people, they won't steal, they'll treat your children well, and they take pride in that. Have you looked into this a little bit?
Well, it's so funny you mentioned that, because I was the talking head in that film.
Oh, that was you?
Yeah. I was so much younger. That was like 20 years ago. Like you said, very different pool, right? Remember I was saying that you have, so it's like, so we have this notion of domestic work, but like we really have a limited, what I've come to realize is that we have very limited knowledge of domestic work for the vast majority of them, and that the domestic workers that we've been looking at, and I think because of the convenience of access, has really been those who are in Western or Westernized countries. And those are the ones with resources, and those are the ones who are like highly educated prior to migration, and those are the ones who are, so there are these that was also a time when networks were driving their migration. So the migration to Italy, which is what was talked about in that film, it was really driven by the Catholic Church. So like the Catholic priest in a church in Rome will have a parishioner who says, I am desperate for a childcare worker. And then they have a Filipino nun who's like, there's someone in my village. That's how it actually started. That's how Filipinos started going there. So it's like very network driven. So that's why in Italy, it's mostly from three areas of the country that are represented in Italy. So in contrast, the UAE, they're from the southern tip to the northern tip of the country, and it doesn't really matter. It's not really your friends directly in that country anymore, but these agencies. So it's like a very different makeup of people. So it's a very, very impoverished people. The extent of poverty basically is like, they have never seen a toaster oven. They have never seen not even a stove. And so we saw that when we went to the training sessions. I mean, it was kind of like mind-boggling, because you're like, oh my God, they've never seen a toaster oven. It was really like eye-opening for us, And so these were individuals who grew up in super, super, super remote areas. I can't even emphasize that enough. And some of them, it's funny, I've gotten invited by my interviewees, but I was like kind of scared to go because they're in the Muslim region. And so one of the places that a lot of my interviewees come from is Basilan Island. It's like a lot of terrorists are there. And they are like, oh, come and we'll give you bodyguards. I'm like, no, thank you. So it's not, so there are no domestic workers from Basilan in Italy, right? Unlikely that they'll even be in Hong Kong because it costs $3,600 to go there. But they have to actually pay for it. And for these women, it's like they don't even have $2 to pay for the electricity, right? And so what we have found is that there is this group of what we're calling fourth world migrants. And
and that these fourth world migrants, it's like a very different experience of migration that they have. It's like agency driven. It's like really like incredibly poor people who like, you know, not really traveled at all. Like, so even like the training sessions, it's like this. It's like, okay, you're gonna get to the airport, and then you're gonna see these counters, and then you look at your ticket and you will see United. Then you go look United, and then that's where you're supposed to go. And then you go there. Then they're gonna take your bag. Don't worry, your bag is gonna put, they're not stealing your bag. They're putting the bag in the airplane. And then they're gonna give you this piece of paper. Then there's this, it's called a boarding pass. And then there will be a number there that says gate. Then you're, it's like really like the stuff that we don't think about, you know? And that's like what happens in the training session. And so that's like, that's not the people who end up in Rome, right? And so it's a very different group of people. And so I think, yeah, maybe they're going for self-discovery, maybe they're going to like better themselves, but I think their primary motivation to go to a very undesirable destination, you know, is not, yeah, it's not, yeah, like I don't think it's, if they could help it, they would rather go somewhere else, right? So they're going there because, yeah, they don't have much of a choice. Yeah.
I think we've come to the end of our time in this room. I want to, again, thank Professor Perinas for a fabulous talk and an excellent discussion. Thanks so much for your
Thank you.
So, thank you.